Every year, China moves more than 44.8 billion cubic meters of water across the country. That's the equivalent of 18 million Olympic swimming pools, flowing through concrete canals, underground tunnels, and even beneath entire mountain ranges. This isn't fiction, it's real. It's the South-North Water Transfer Project, one of the most expensive and ambitious infrastructure efforts in human history. With a total length exceeding 3,000 kilometers, a cost north of $70 billion, and over 330,000 people relocated, it's an engineering marvel on a continental scale. But why would any country attempt to reshape nature like this? To understand that, we have to go back to 1952 to a simple idea that sparked one of the largest civil engineering projects on Earth. In the early years of the People's Republic of China, Chairman Mao Zedong looked at the nation's geography and made a blunt observation. The South has plenty of water, the North lacks it, so let's borrow some. That one sentence became the foundation of China's water strategy for the next 70 years. The issue was, and still is, deeply geographical. Southern China, with rivers like the Yangtze, floods regularly and often has too much water. Meanwhile, northern cities like Beijing and Tianjin have been running dry for decades. Underground aquifers in the north are being depleted faster than they can refill. Wells are dug deeper and deeper. In places like Hebei Province, the ground is literally sinking, land subsidence caused by water extraction. The imbalance became impossible to ignore. By the 1990s, China wasn't just planning anymore, it was building. The eastern route follows the path of the 2,500-year-old Grand Canal, once used by emperors to move rice and goods. But instead of barges, it now carries water. It starts at the Yangtze River near Yangzhou and moves water northward using 23 massive pumping stations that push it over 1,000 kilometers, even sending water beneath the Yellow River, a feat that required cutting-edge tunneling technology. The first water reached Shandong Province in 2014, and later reached Tianjin. Today, this route supplies over 10 million people with clean water. But the project wasn't without problems. The Grand Canal runs through some of the most heavily industrialized and farmed areas in China. Decades of pollution, pesticides, fertilizers, factory runoff, meant the water was far from clean. In Dongping Lake, fish farmers reported mass die-offs. Water treatment plants had to be built all along the route before the project could even start flowing. That's one of the challenges with moving rivers through civilization. What you're really moving is everything in them, good and bad. The central route is even more impressive and more controversial. It starts at the Danjiangku Reservoir, part of the Han River system, and stretches over 1,200 kilometers to Beijing. Unlike the Eastern Line, it doesn't rely on pumps. Instead, engineers designed it to use gravity, carefully planning elevation drops so water flows on its own the entire way. It supplies Beijing with one-third of its water, helps recharge lakes and aquifers, and delivers cleaner water than the city has seen in decades. But there's a human cost. To build the Danjiangku Reservoir and the canals that followed, over 330,000 people were relocated. Entire villages were submerged. Families who had lived in the same place for generations had to leave. And there's an environmental toll. Pulling water from the Han River affects communities downstream. To reduce the impact, China has proposed a 10-year tunnel project connecting the Three Gorges Dam to the Han River, a plan that would create the longest and deepest water tunnel ever attempted. That's still being studied, but the ambition is clear. Keep the North hydrated, no matter the cost. The third and final phase, the Western Route, exists only on paper for now, and many hope it stays that way. This route would cut through the Tibetan Plateau, tapping into rivers like the Mekong and the Brahmaputra, critical sources of water for countries like India, Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. This raises serious geopolitical risks. Diverting those rivers upstream could spark international conflict, and it's not just politics. Engineering a canal or tunnel through the earthquake-prone Himalayas is a high-stakes gamble. Landslides, collapses, and unpredictable weather make the terrain nearly impossible. Still, the project hasn't been canceled, just paused. The need for water in northern China isn't going away. With more than $70 billion spent, critics ask if this project was the right solution. Could China have invested in desalination plants, urban pipe repair, or industrial water recycling instead? Possibly, but supporters point to real wins. Beijing now has cleaner drinking water. Rivers and lakes once reduced to mud puddles have refilled. Groundwater levels in the north have stopped dropping, or even started rising again. Industry, farming, and city life in the north have stabilized. Still, not everyone benefits equally. Some rural villages near the canals don't get access to the water flowing past them. Evaporation losses are a constant issue along open canals, and pollution remains a threat, especially in regions with outdated factories and farms. China isn't done refining the system. Experts are calling for covering canals to stop evaporation. Smart sensors are being deployed to track flow, leaks, and pollution in real time. On the central route alone, there are now 60 check gates and 90 diversion points, managed by a new digital control center that improves response times by a factor of 5. This is no longer just a system of concrete and steel. It's becoming a data-driven infrastructure, with engineers using analytics to predict problems before they happen. It's smart engineering, but it still depends on nature. There's one variable that no engineer can control: climate. Southern China is getting drier. The Yangtze River has dropped to historic lows in recent years. Glaciers that feed the river's source are melting at unpredictable rates. If the water supply in the south shrinks, the entire system begins to wobble. That's the paradox. China has moved rivers. But the rivers themselves are changing. If the south can't supply enough water, cities in the north may face another crisis, one even more difficult to solve. The South-North Water Transfer Project is the largest of its kind in human history. 3,000 kilometers of canals and tunnels. $70 billion. Millions of lives impacted. It's a story of ambition, scale, sacrifice, and a reminder that no matter how advanced we get, we're still at the mercy of nature. Now, China faces a choice. Should it finish the Western route or stop here? What do you think? Let us know in the comments below. And if you want to see more videos like this, exploring the engineering, politics, and consequences behind the world's biggest projects, hit like, subscribe, and turn on notifications. Thanks for watching.